First is that we were basically immigrants, right? Because I was born here, but the rest of my family wasn't. They came from Puerto Rico. They could speak Spanish. I had no idea what they were talking about. Because my whole thing of understanding kind of was already like in English. And the first people I met when I left the door, you know, when I walked into the hallway of my building, were my colored neighbors. We were all colored then. But, you know, the African Americans who lived here, some of them came up from the South and they lived in my building. And the barrio was very, very mixed like that. So my first friends were these black cats, you see, which was very different from a lot of Puerto Rican experience here in the barrio. Because that was like really, what do you call that, an anomaly, you know, to an extent, even though we have a cultural connection. But what happened is, so my black friends, they started teaching me how to, you know, about English, you know, and so mainly curse words, but you know, but other thing, and, you know, and then I began to figure that out. Now, I didn't know I was going to be a writer. A lot of people, I wrote when I lived in El Barrio, but I really got into writing when we moved to the Bronx, which was in 64. So I lived for 14 years, or 13 and a half years here in El Barrio. But I was basically taking notes. You know, and by the time I moved to the Bronx, I had all these pieces of paper and blah, blah, and some of them were poems and some of them were not, and I would develop them. I was very energetic and you know, just, and see, and because I didn't know how to write well in terms of commas and periods, you know, structure, you know, then I had to invent my own structure to create the same things, which punctuation is the traffic signals of literature, right? Stop, go, yield right away. All that, right? Mm-hmm. Here comes a new freeway. You know, whatever, right? So I didn't know about that. I didn't know where to put a comma or why. You know what I mean? I knew that a sentence began, capital letter, ended, a period. But then when you're writing poetry and you don't have this, so you figure out that what they're actually doing is creating blank space and silences. So you could do that on the paper. You know, just by moving words, you saw how you had to move stuff away from it. Okay, that's, you know, I didn't know that a comma could do the same thing, but the blank space. So that's how I started playing around with things and pieces. It's kind of like Legos. You know, like Legos poetry, you know.
And, were you reading poets at that point? Because a lot of poets in the 60s, people like Ginsberg. And,
no, I was a little kid. I was in 1960, I was 10. Nah, I'm reading for long. No, I wasn't reading. There weren't textbooks in the house, and my house wasn't like a like your house. Your house, was, I imagine, was a literary house. There were books in shelves. You know, we had books. You know, over there. I don't remember novels in my house. You know, in our apartment. The books that were in my apartment were generally the books that we got from school. Whatever textbook they gave us, you know, at the beginning of the year, that. My sister's workbooks, all of that. That was my interest. In fact, one of my teachers said, I don't understand how a guy who can write so well is so disinterested in reading. I said, wow, I never thought, but yeah, I was basically disinterested in reading. I was tactile. You know, I just, you know, spongy, you know. That's been my experience, you know.
But yeah, I mean, you published really early on, right? You have a couple of your first books are from when you were your late teens, right?
Early 20s.
So what was that process from playing around with stuff on paper to being a published poet at age 19 or 20, right?
Well, I liked print. And, you know, you see, a lot of people don't realize that a lot of this stuff was kind of new, like television. Television was a new invention, you know? People didn't even know how it worked, large by and large. I mean, because you bought a piece of furniture and you plugged it in the wall and the world came. How'd that happen? You know, I mean, that just spits out electricity, not images. You know what I'm saying? So, you know, there was a time when that was like a really like, how does this work type of thing. And people having a TV in their house was a big deal, you know. So, yeah, all that poverty. But the thing is that I like printing. I remember I used to take potatoes and you know, carve out letters backwards, you know, and make rubber stamps, you know. I would always do stuff like that as a kid. I don't know, I just liked printing stuff. And then I was sloppy about it too, because I'd make a mess. Okay, here's the story. I had all these poems in an attaché case. I tell the story. I tried one day, I would write something and just throw it in there and close it. It was attaché my brother gave me. But in reality, it was only about 3 inches or so, you know, tall, right? And so one day, I did my routine. I wrote something, because at least I knew that. Write something, you know, that you think, and you know, that's a way of preserving it, you see? So I preserved it, and I threw it in there, and it wouldn't close, because it was full. And I opened it up and mashed papers up. It wouldn't close, and I was like, oh, now what am I going to do? You know, now I'm a little ghetto kid, so I don't know about files. I don't know about file cabinets. You know what I mean, Matt? I learned things on television, like Donna Reed, you know, My Three Sons. You know what I mean? That's how I learned about America. You know, those people, they got grass outside their house. I mean, they walk outside and they're in the park. You know, that, you got to understand, this is like an immigrant reality. You know what I mean? You come to a new world and, you know, and even though, you know, we weren't like immigrant in the sense of, you know, coming from Europe, we are citizens anyway, but still, it's a strange world, and I didn't speak English that well. I didn't speak English that well, but I understood. I didn't speak Spanish. You know, I didn't speak Spanish. I mean, my grandma would talk to me, and I look at her like, what the hell is going on here? I remember thinking that, why do old people talk weird? I remember that. But anyway, I couldn't close it. And so I had this dilemma because I had all these things. I said, now what am I going to do? And my brother suggested that I should type them because that would make them smaller. Now, that was a good and bad suggestion because, see, what I did was, I typed them, but then I threw away the original notes. You see, which is something I don't do now. You know, Didi, right? I forget it. I got every, if I started a piece of paper, if I started a poem on a piece of gum paper, the gum paper would probably be part of the archive. It gets stapled in there too, you know, because it's part of the process. And I like, but not then. So anyway, so I started typing these. And here's the funny thing.
Wasn't it in a class you mentioned that you took a class in?
No, I took a class later, but before okay. I'm typing these poems, I didn't know how you got ink onto the thing, right? And I didn't know about the ribbons. So I thought that you poured ink into the typewriter someplace. You know, it would have a reservoir someplace. I'm looking. So I couldn't figure it out, you know. And I've seen, you know, printing presses and the whole thing. So I said to myself, well, I guess you pour it right on this thing here, right? So I poured it on the platinum, right? Right across. And it was, you know, in those days, everybody had ink, you know, bottled ink. And, you know, remember those? They came in these weird shaped bottles that some one of them would tilt over and it was still for the pen. Really crazy. Anyway, I poured it in there. And of course, it went right through the whole thing. Landed on my mother's Formica table, which of course was white. And I spent the rest of the day trying to Ajax that out of there. You know, this big blue spot. Remember that blue ink? Remember it's a particular blue
India ink.
Anyway, so that's why I typed my poems. And when I went to school, I saw they had a printing press. And I liked, you know, to me it was something. They used to have shop in the schools. They had electricity, wood shop, and printing, and something else. They had all kinds of wood, electric, metal.
Home
wood.
Economics.
Yeah, well, yeah, the guys didn't take home economics. You know, they good. Anyway, so that's, I basically started typing my poem. Very experimental process that I think, in my opinion, young poets today, you know, all the spoken word, they don't go through that process. You know, they don't see, and it's like failure to do long division. You see what I mean? And in long division, you get to understand the numbers a little bit more. You know, the power of 6/5.
that's an important point you're making, because a lot of folks might know, you know, contemporary spoken word or slam identified poets or HBO's deaf poetry, but a lot of that comes from what the experiments that you were doing, right?
Yeah,
the poets
yeah.
like you were doing, right?
Yeah,
in neighborhoods like this, right? But that history gets erased, right?
Right.
Because it's not sexy and not commercial,
well,
right?
So, Isaac Newton stuff, you know? It's like, you know, no, really, you know, it's like getting hit with an apple and realizing gravity, you know? That kind of stuff.
So when did you realize that poetry was a thing, that it wasn't just something that you were playing around with, but that poets were protesting, you know, that the poets were involved in social movements, that some of those poets were Puerto Rican?
Well, see, that all happened. Right? That all happened. See, okay, I knew about Langston Hughes, I knew about some poets, you know, the night before Christmas and stuff like that. You know, St. Nick's, whatever. You know, like very, I'm trying to tell you, I had a very limited, like a cloistered kind of world that I lived in. But, and I didn't know this, but I'm punching holes through it. You see what I mean? But I don't know that. You see, my own trying to figure things. I think it's interesting if you look, you know, we talk about it. I go, yeah, that was pretty interesting. So anyway, when I was a teenager, and you know, I've been writing for a while, since I was a little kid, but I didn't know what this was. One of my teachers told me that what I had been writing was poetry. Now, check that out. She tells me that I've been writing poetry. And I, you know, I told her, no, not me. You know, I could never write a poem. You know, she says, no, these things are poems. They're already poems, she's telling me. She said, all you have to do is fix them up a little bit. She said, smooth the edges. That's what it was, smooth the edges. And you know, like I kind of innately understood what she was talking about. You know, she showed me a little bit. But the thing that's profound to me about that is my refusal to accept me being a poet. Just you know, out of hand. Just like, no, these are poems. Oh, well, then I must be a poet. You know, I said, no, they can't possibly be poems. They're just things I write. You know, like, and I like that as discovery and humility, and you know what I mean? Not bogarting something, but actually saying, oh yeah? It's, you know, I know that watching the Oscars, for instance, a lot of those people who were there for the very first time was unbelievable to them. You know? Like, I'm actually up for an award. You know, I actually might get it, you know, and blah, 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 all of that, you know, type of thing. I had that kind of wonder, you know, in terms of writing. And then, all these movements are happening. You have the Black Arts Movement, which was already happening, but I'm a little kid. You see, I'm 13, 14, 15. Then everything is, now you gotta look at this. 1963, 64, 65, 66, see where we're going? 67, 68, and Papo's 17, 18 now. And now I realize what's going on, and people are writing and blah, blah. I didn't see it as a profession or anything. It's just that if you could do this, then say something, just like if you could do that, then do that. You see what I'm saying? Like, you know, if you could draw a line that depicts something, then go ahead, you know, and say something. And so that's basically what was going on. I think it was very non-narcissistic. Like, I see a lot of things going on nowadays, you know, I think, and things are getting watered down, become mediocre, and, you know, people don't want to struggle for something because they think there is no struggle in getting it. You know what I mean? It just appears and it's there. You know, and you know, and we're losing a lot of the fabric of society, the things that we talked about, you know, walking around in Barrio that were so tangible and tactile and so full of life and everything. And now, you know, people are cloistering themselves, everybody, you know, locked up. You know, and you know, things are different. And then the gentrification, I got neighbors, I know they're my neighbors, they don't talk to me. It's like, they're not my neighbor, they're just the person that lives next door. You know, they just live next door.
Yes. Well, I'm wondering if you could talk maybe about, I mean, the scene here, maybe about the Young Lords.
And they have a bunch of questions, these guys.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah,
and they want to hear more poems.
Right? We're working away that, but you know, about that era, maybe the Young Lords, because that's so important to the topic that they're discussing, right?
Okay.
And
well, the
whole question of relationship between poets, community activists, and, you know, and the opposition, right? To either
well,
to
all of this,
to,
we call it like a diaspora, right?
Yeah.
All of this is like a bubbling cauldron or something. You know, it's all happened, but, you know, the black students are doing this and that. Some of these posters are about taking over when one of these, which one is it, each other? One about Ostos or City College? You know, we started, well, the colleges that we started, and some of these posters are the posters for those demonstrations and stuff like that. So all of this is all happening at the same time, and we're all coming of age. Because of it. And
that's an important point for all you all to know, right? That it's not that your professor decided one day that you should learn, you know, Black or Puerto Rican poets along with Shakespeare. It's that these people fought to actually protest it, right, outside of the city universities, right, to make sure that there were courses
right,
that reflected
that's how we got
their background, their
open
experience.
Open admissions,
right?
Hunter College.
What we call ethnic studies, right, which right. Your school might have, right, Puerto Rican, African American, Asian American.
To fight for those
that
things.
Was the people of those communities yeah. fighting because they didn't see themselves in the curriculum. They didn't write literature, right?
Right.
Everyone, somebody else wrote literature, they just studied it, right?
So, yeah, that's what gets me angry now is because our fight was to actually be literary artists once I realized that's what we were doing. Okay, we want to be literary, we want to be, well, we're poets. We don't want to be, you know, subtitle something, you know, in all the books and Norton and everything, you got to get it. I mean, that's what happens. But you're individually, you want to be accepted as, you know, as a poet, as a writer, you know? And nowadays, I just think it's twisted where, you know, that's not the important thing. The important thing is performing and being out there and spotlighted. So I think a lot of the artistic part of things, because I don't know what their process is. I know mine is writing, you know, and in the writing is the rhythm and everything else, and you know, I give voice to it while I'm doing it to make sure that that's what's happening. You know, that's the thing, you know, but it's more mental than it is vocal. It becomes vocal. But it's mental, you know. I always say that poetry is an outside in thing, meaning that the inspiration comes from the outside and enters the vehicle, the poet, in order for that to maturate and mix up with the experiences of the individual to come out as a poem, you see. And the difference between inspiration and what was the other one? I have this thing about it. It's like an imagination. They're two separate things. You see, like I would say that inspiration is the thing that sparks the imagination. Imagination is separate altogether, and imagination comes from memory. So the more you know, the more imaginative you can be. You see, because you fill up your mind with memory and information, and therefore you can utilize that to express yourself when the inspiration comes from the outside to spark the imagination. And for me, it's always something particular too, I think, for everybody. If, especially if you write, it's something that always happens, and that's what gets you to pick up the pen. For me, it's irony, and I know it. I've thought about it a long time, and then I've seen it happen. Because I've always wondered, what is it that gets you to pick up a pen? You know, so when I was younger, I didn't know about anything, I would pick up a pen, you know, and just start writing stuff, because that was that. But then you get older, you know, you change and stuff like that. So I said, I wonder, what is it, you know? And so whenever I see something that strikes me ironic, then that becomes the inspiration. That's a spark to get everything going, you know? And I took in what that was, and now I'm going to deliver the message. The other thing is that I believe that all poems are about empathy. That's what poetry is about. Poetry is about empathy. It's about empathy for humanity and life. That's what all poems are about. No matter what they're talking about, look for it and you'll see it. It's about empathy. Because we're all lost in the world. You see, we're all here, everybody thinks they're more intelligent than that, and you know what I mean? We're all, but we're really lost. You know, when the lights go out, we're all just as scared of the dark as anybody else. You know, so, and total dark, like when you're out in the desert and you look at that and you go, whoa, man, I am really small. You know, like, I'm lucky I'm bigger than the grain of sand I'm looking at. You know, but
barely,
actually,
barely.
Yeah, right. And then that is you. You see what I mean? The translation of that. So it's all of these things. But the poetry is about empathy because I believe that the universe is always talking to us, and the universe always wants us to know things, you know, to help us along in life. And I call them cosmic messages. And we talked about cosmic email. Cosmic messages are just the vibes that the universe sends out, hoping that antennas would receive them. You see, and then the antennas that are receptive get them and do what they will with them. Some cases they turn out to be this, and some cases they turn out to be that.
You mentioned irony. And
oh, it just depends on the dexterity of the receiver.
I mean, you mentioned irony, empathy. It's weird because you think of those as opposite, right? Irony is about questioning information, questioning what you get from somebody else, right? Questioning their motives, right? But empathy is about embracing somebody else, right? And I can see those two things working together, even in your early poetry. I wonder if you could read one of those early poems.
Okay, we got the book. This was cool. Did you guys enjoy this?
Yes.
Oh, thank you very much.
I don't know if you have one in mind, or you want to take a request, or.